Okay. We really appreciate the name of the Lord for giving us another moment of sharing in His Word. And I know that we will be blessed, and He has important things to speak to us. And so I know time has been spent, some minutes wasted, but we thank the Lord for we will try to recover the time. We are in the number 7 of the prophetic mirror. And I just thought, before I go to the book of Daniel chapter 4 and show the parallel of what happened in that time and what will happen in our time, I have to finish up Daniel chapter 3 completely. And today in the prophetic mirror, we are looking at number 7, Daniel 3, an attack on the first commandment, an attack on the first commandment. And so I'll pray, and then we go into the word of the Lord. Shall we pray? Heavenly Father, thank you so much for such a wonderful time again that we study of thy word. We pray of the ministration of thy Holy Spirit, Lord, inspire minds and inspire hearts, that we may be able to comprehend the things that you are speaking unto us and the type, anti-type that is in the book of Daniel chapter 3. And so, Father, let thy will be exalted, and let the glory of man be put in dust, that Christ alone may be enthroned. In your name be glorified now and forevermore in Christ Jesus' name I pray, amen. The other time we were looking at the book of Daniel chapter 3, and it was about liberty of conscience threatened, and the worship that the Lord will accept. But I want to look at Daniel chapter 3 and an attack on the first commandment in Exodus chapter 20. And what it meant in that time, and what it means to us this time. Why did these three Hebrews not bow down to worship when Nebuchadnezzar told them to worship? But what is the first commandment, actually? What is the first commandment? That is something that we have to ask ourselves. In the book of Mark chapter 12, this is what... we find Mark chapter 12. We are told from verse 28, and one of the scribes came, and having heard them reasoning together and perceiving that he had under them well, asked him, which is the first commandment of all? And Jesus answered him, the first of all the commandments is, hear, O Israel, the Lord our God is our Lord, and thou shalt love the Lord thy God with all thy heart, and with all thy soul, and with all thy mind, and with all thy strength. This is the first commandment. And so, and the second is like, namely this, thou shalt love thy neighbor as thyself. There is none other commandment greater than this. And so, speaking about the first commandment, we find that it is the first four tables of the book of Exodus chapter 20, when God is giving his commands. And then the last six commandments is the second commandment, which applies how man deals with man. And so when the three Hebrew authors were brought into a situation where they had to disobey the first commandment of the table of the stone, which is, I'm the Lord, the God who brought you out of Egypt. Thou shalt have no other gods besides me. And then telling them that thou shalt not make any image, whether on the earth, in the heavens, or in the seas, and worship it. And thou shalt not take the name of the Lord, thy God, in vain, and then keep the Sabbath holy. All these were pointing to the creator of the heavens and the earth. And so when Nebuchadnezzar raised that image, it was actually an attack on the first table of the commandments. And so Daniel, the three Hebrews understanding what was really at stake, they decided they are not going to bow down to this to this image. And so I want just to look at this aspect of the attack of the first commandment, how it was then and how it will come to happen. But more on this, I'll be dealing with it in Revelation chapter 18, but I just want to give a synopsis of why these three Hebrew worthies were not, could not allow themselves to bow down to this image. When you go to the book of Deuteronomy chapter 13, verses 1 and 3, the book of Deuteronomy chapter 13, verses 1 and 3, we are told, if there arise among you a prophet or a dreamer of dreams, and giveth thee a sign or wonder, and the sign or the wonder comes to pass, whereof he spake unto thee, saying, let us go after other gods, which thou hast not known, and let us serve them, thou shalt not hearken unto the words of the prophet or that dreamer of dreams. For the Lord your God proveth you to know whether you love the Lord your God with all your heart and with all your soul. So when the three Hebrew worthies who used to read the parchment of the scroll really remembered what had been given unto them in the book of Deuteronomy chapter 13, verses 1 to 3, they felt that they could not bow down to this image, that it was against the will of God for an Israelite to bow down to anything that was against what they had been given in the law of Moses. The special counsels that arose out of the general precept were really contained in the book of Deuteronomy chapter 12, verse 32, which tells the Israelites actually to only obey the commandments of God and not to obey any man. And so this really brought the key issue that Israelites had been warned against and what had made them go into captivity, the issue of idolatry. The issue of idolatry, where the children of Israel started to worship Molech, they started to bow down to Baal, and they started to discredit the Sabbath, made them go into captivity. And so when the three Hebrew worthies really remembered what had brought them into captivity, they decided, no, we shall not bow down to these things. And so antitypically, the people who will be faced with the mark of the beast, it is not just about Sunday sacredness, but it is about worshiping unto the God whom our fathers never knew about. And it should be our aim to know, are we worshiping the Lord on the right day and the right Lord, or we are even worshiping the Lord on the right day and worshiping the wrong God? And so these faithfuls, they could not bring them unto worship of any false gods. The Babylonians were known for their worship of false god, which started at Babylon. And you see, when Nimrod is raising that that building at Babel, there was the concept of bowing down to Nimrod and the wife Semiramis, and then later on their son Tammuz. These are the things which are found in the book of Jeremiah and also the book of Ezekiel chapter 8. In Jeremiah, you find that the women are kneeling down and offering it to the Queen of Heaven. Let us just go to the book of Jeremiah. Jeremiah chapter, is it chapter 7? Jeremiah chapter 7. Let us look at Jeremiah chapter 7, what was happening in Israel as they were going to captivity. Jeremiah chapter 7. And let us, in the book of Jeremiah chapter 7, it says that the word that came to Jeremiah from the Lord, saying, stand in the gates of the Lord's house and proclaim there this word, and say, hear the word of the Lord, all ye of Judah that enter in at the gates to worship the Lord. Thus saith the Lord of hosts, the God of Israel, amend your ways and your doings, and I'll cause you to dwell in this place. Trust ye not in lying words, saying the temple of the Lord, the temple of the Lord, of the Lord are this. And then he goes ahead in verse 14, says, therefore I'll do unto this which is called by my name wherein ye trust, and unto the place which I gave to you and your fathers, as I have done to Shiloh. Shiloh is where actually the ark was taken by the Philistine, and the two sons of Eli, Hones and Phinehas, were taken by the Philistine, and the ark taken, and then one of the wife of the sons of Eli gave birth to a son, and he was called Ichabod. The glory had departed. And so at Shiloh, the glory of the Lord departed. And then he is telling the house of Israel, because you are doing these things, I'll depart from you and you'll be taken into captivity. And he says in verse 15, and I'll cast you out of my sight as I have cast out all your brethren, even the whole seed of Ephraim. You understand what Amos and Hosea says, that Ephraim is joined unto idol, leave him alone. Verse 16, therefore pray not thou for these people, neither lift up cry nor prayer for them, neither make intercession to me, for I'll not hear thee. Seest thou what they do in the cities of Judah and in the streets of Jerusalem? These are the sins they are committing, and these are the sins that really makes them go into Babylonian captivity. And when they enter into Babylonian captivity, the king of Babylon makes an image, and he wants them to continue with the same worship they had in Judah and Jerusalem. What were these people doing? Jeremiah 7:18. The children gather wood, and the fathers kindle the fire, and the women knead their dough to make cakes to the queen of heaven. This is the wife of Nimrod, Semiramis, and to pour out drink offering unto gods, that they may provoke me to anger. Adam Clark says that this is, how is this? This is Jupiter also. They were worshiping the planet Jupiter, or the star Jupiter. And so the Lord said, do they provoke me to anger? Said the Lord, do they provoke themselves to the confusion of their own faces? So they were really worshiping this false god. When you go to Ezekiel chapter 8, the book of Ezekiel chapter 8, you find more abomination that is going on in Israel. In the book of Ezekiel chapter 8, it says, then said the Lord, verse 12, he unto me, son of man, hast thou seen what the ancient of the house of Israel do in the dark, every man in the chambers of his imagery? For they say, the Lord seeth not, the Lord hath forsaken the earth. He said also unto me, turn thee yet again, and thou shalt see great abomination that they do. Then he brought me to the door of the gate of the Lord's house, which was toward the north, and behold, there sat women weeping for Tammuz. This is the son of Nimrod. Then said unto me, hast thou seen this, O son of man? Turn thee yet again, thou shalt see greater abomination than this. And he brought me into the inner court of the Lord's house, and behold, at the door of the temple of the Lord, between the porch and the altar, were about 25 men with their backs toward the temple of the Lord, and their faces toward the east, and they worshiped the sun toward the east. And so they were not just weeping for Nimrod, Semiramis, and Tammuz, but they had turned their backs to the temple, and they were worshiping facing the sun. They were doing sun worship, which was made up of these Trinitarian gods. And so when the three Hebrew artists were brought into Babylon, and Nebuchadnezzar made this image, they decided in their heart, we will not continue to do the abomination that is being done in Judah and Jerusalem. And so as Moses had forbidden this sun worship and idolatry in the book of Deuteronomy, they remembered because they had been acquainted with what actually the Bible was saying. When you read the book of Deuteronomy chapter 13, verse 4 to 9, the book of Deuteronomy chapter 13, 4 to 9, we are told, ye shall walk after the Lord your God, and fear him, and keep his commandments, and obey his voice, and you shall serve him, and cleave unto him. And that prophet, or that dream of dreams, shall be put to death, because he hath spoken to turn you away from the Lord your God, which brought you out of the land of Egypt. This is an attack on the first commandment on the table, and redeemed you out of the house of the bondage, to thrust thee out of the way which the Lord thy God commanded thee to walk in. Moses continues saying, so that thou put the evil away from the midst of thee. Verse 6 of Deuteronomy chapter 13. If thy brother, the son of thy mother, or thy son, or thy daughter, or the wife of thy bosom, or thy friend, which is as thine own soul, entice thee secretly, saying, let us go and serve other gods which thou hast not known, nor thy fathers, namely of the gods of the people which are around about you. You understand that this Hebrew worthies were in Babylon. And King Nebuchadnezzar was telling them, let us worship this image, because it was a representation of the sun god, of their gods. Moses had clearly said that if you are enticed to do this, whether in public or in secret, that you should serve this god, what shall you do? Thou shall not, verse 8, Deuteronomy chapter 13, verse 8, thou shall not consent unto him, nor hearken unto him, neither shall thine eye pity him, neither shall thou spare, neither shall thou conceal him. But thou shalt surely kill him, thine hand shall be first upon him to put him to death, and afterward the hand of all the people. But now the three Hebrew worthies could not kill Nebuchadnezzar. They were really in a foreign country. And so they had no power to kill Nebuchadnezzar. What they had is the power to refuse to do what Nebuchadnezzar was telling them. In the book of Deuteronomy chapter 13, verse 10 to 18, we are told this. And thou shalt stone him with stones, that he die, because he hath sought to thrust thee away from the Lord thy God. I'm reading from Deuteronomy 13, from verse 10 to 18. Verse 11, and all Israel shall hear and fear, and shall do no more any such a wickedness as this is among you. Verse 12, it says, if thou shalt hear, say, in one of thy cities which the Lord thy God hath given thee to dwell there, saying, certain men, the children of Belial, are gone out from among you and have withdrawn the inhabitants of their city, saying, let us go and serve other gods which we have not known, then shall thou inquire and make search and ask diligently, and behold, if it be truth and the thing certain that such an abomination is wrought among you, thou shalt surely smite the inhabitants of that city with the edge of the sword, destroying it utterly, and all that is therein, and the cattle thereof with the edge of the sword. And thou shalt gather all the spoil of it into the midst of the street thereof, and shalt burn with fire the city and all the spoil thereof, every whit, for the Lord thy God, and it shall be all an heap forever, it shall not be built again. And there shall be, verse 17, and there shall cleave not of the cursed thing to thine hand, that the Lord may turn from the fierceness of his anger, and shew thee mercy, and have compassion upon thee, and multiply thee, as he hath sworn unto thy fathers. When thou shalt hearken to the voice of the Lord thy God, to keep all his commandments, which I command thee this day, to do that which is right in the eyes of the Lord thy God. And so, these Hebrew worthies, they could not in any way worship the idols, because they had been prohibited in the law, and because they could not kill the king of Babylon, they refused it and waited upon the Lord to save them. And so the king of Babylon had raised an image against the God of heaven to attack the first commandment on the table of stones. The law forbade this. And so the Lord had to see a people who will stand for him at that time. And as we shall be going through the book of Revelation chapter 18, you shall see vividly that actually the end time war, it's not just about the day of worship, but when you worship, who you worship, how you worship, and where you worship. This is an important thing, and it will bring many people into great straits. And so the Lord prohibits any worship of foreign image. And so the people, like, you see, Israel got into a lot of apostasy, and then the law was hidden from them until what was being told to the people was just the ideas and the notions of men. And by the time they were being taken into Babylonian captivity, they were in full-fledged worship of idols. And Ezra, when they found the book of the law, we find this in Spiritual Gifts, Volume 4. When they found what was going on, that it was idol worship, in the book of the law, they found when they were actually making up the temple, in Spiritual Gifts, Volume 4, page 72, this is what we are told. Spiritual Gifts, Volume 4, page 72. This is actually what we are told when they found the book of the law. This is in Ezra chapter 8, verses 21 to 23. He says, if you are searching, search 4BSG 72.2. This is a commentary on Ezra chapter 8, verses 21 to 23. The prophet of the Lord said, then remember, this is in the context of finding the book of the law and Ezra trying to bring back people to the true worship of the Lord. And the people were obstinate and they were hard-hearted. Have you found it? Then I proclaimed a fast there at the river Ahava, that we might afflict ourselves before our God to seek of him a right way for us and for our little ones and for all our substance. For I was ashamed to require of the king a band of soldiers and horsemen to us to help us against the enemy in the way, because we had spoken unto the king, saying, the hand of our God is upon all them for good that seek him, but his power and his wrath is against all them that forsake him. So we fasted and besought our God for this, and he was entreated of us. But he continued to say, the prophet and these fathers did not consider them the worshippers of the true God. And though they professed friendship and wished to help them, they dare not unite with them in anything relating to his worship. There are people who said that, let us come build the temple with you. Let us help you building the temple. But these were not considered the true worshipers, the worshipers of true God. And Ezra refused because the house of the Lord could be discredited by the people who are worshipers of the false God. So when going up to Jerusalem, remember this is in rebuilding Jerusalem, to build the temple of God and to restore his worship, they will not ask help of the king to assist them in the way, but by fasting and prayer sought the Lord for help. They believed God will defend and prosper his servants in their effort to serve him. The creator of all things needed not the help of his enemies to establish his worship. He asked the sacrifice of wickedness nor accept the offering of those who have other gods before the Lord. We often hear the remark, you are too exclusive. As a people, we will make any sacrifice to save souls or lead them to truth. But to unite with them, to love the things that they love and have friendship with the world, we dare not. For we should then be at enmity with God. The Israel of God in these last days are in constant danger of mingling with the world. So you find that the very things Ezra and the people who are in Babylon were going through are the very things that will happen to the people in the end time. And so the lessons that the three Hebrew worthies exhibited really have to be exhibited or manifested in our lives once again, and losing all signs of their being the chosen people of God. So we cannot risk losing all signs of being the chosen of God. And we are told, read again Titus 2, verses 13 to 15, where we have to actually refrain from every kind of ungodliness. We are brought down to the last days when God is purifying unto himself a peculiar people. Shall we provoke God as did ancient Israel? Shall we bring this wrath upon us by departing from him and mingling with the world and following the abominations of the nations around us? Continuing on, the prophet says, the Lord has set apart him that is godly for himself, and this consecration to God and separation from the world is plainly declared and positively enjoined in both the Old and the New Testament. There is a wall of separation which the Lord himself has established between the things of the world and things he has chosen out of the world and sanctified unto himself. The calling and character of God's people are peculiar. Their prospects are peculiar, and these peculiarities distinguish them from all the people. All of God's people upon the earth are one body from the beginning to the end of time. They have one head that directs and governs the body. The same injunction rests upon God's people now to be separate from the world as rested upon ancient Israel. The great head of the church has not changed. The experience of Christians in these days is much like the travels of ancient Israel. Please read 1 Corinthians 10, especially from 6 to 15 verse, which says that these things happen unto them as examples for whom the end of the world have come. Wherefore, my dearly beloved, flee from idolatry. I speak as to wise men, judge ye what I say. The world is ripening for its destruction. God can bear with sinners but a little longer. They must drink the dregs of the cup of his wrath and mixed with mercy. Those who will be heirs of God and joint heirs with Jesus Christ to the immortal inheritance will be peculiar. Yes, so peculiar that God places a mark upon them as his, wholly his. Think ye that God will receive, honor, and acknowledge a people so mixed up with the world that they differ from them only by name? I tell you, this will not happen. And so the same thing that these people are facing in Babylon are the same things that we are facing right now in the ends of the earth. It's not only the image of Sunday that is really raised for us to worship, but who is receiving that worship of Sunday? It is not only about the day, but it is about whom are we really worshiping. These, the things that happen in the book of Daniel chapter 3, the raising of the image and the three Hebrew worthies bowing down to worship them, were not actually just bowing to the image, but for the God that that image represented. And so when we speak about Sunday worshiping, it is not just about the day, because it is God who created the day, but who is behind the enforcement of worshiping on that day. God is responsible for the worshiping on the Sabbath day. And he really instruct us to appear before him on Sabbath to worship him. This is his command. And so if another person would come with a command that we should worship on Sunday, then that worship will not be directed to the creator of that day, but to the person who has commanded that day to be worshipped. And so when we appear before the Lord on Sabbath to worship, that is the Lord whom we worship. If we appear on Sunday to worship, we are worshiping the person behind the creation or the sanction of Sunday worship. Let us continue to look at why this worship, it was refused by these three Hebrew worthies. Let us look at why it was refused by these three Hebrew worthies. We are told, many of the prophecies are about to be fulfilled in quick succession. I'm reading from Maranatha 30, paragraph 4. That is Mark 30, paragraph 4 onward. Many of the prophecies are about to be fulfilled in quick succession. Do you have it? Every element of power is about to be set to work. Past history will be done what? Repeated. All controversies will arouse new life, and peril will beset God's people on every side. Intensity is taking hold of the human family. It is permeating everything upon the earth. So whatever you saw happening in the book of Daniel chapter 3, don't think that it is in the past. It is going to be resurrected. The old controversies will be resurrected. And then we are told what? Paragraph 5, study Revelation in connection with what? Daniel, for history will be repeated. We, with all our religious advantages, ought to know far more today than we do. We have no time to lose. Troublous times are before us. The world is stirred with the spirit of war. Soon the sins of trouble spoken of in the prophecies will take place. The prophecy in the 11th of Daniel has nearly reached its complete fulfillment. Much of the history that has taken place in fulfillment of this prophecy will be repeated. In the 13th verse, a power is spoken of that shall be grieved and return and have indignation against the holy covenant. So shall he do, he shall even return and have intelligence with them that forsake the holy covenant. This is 13 MR. 394.1. And so we are told, sorry for that. We are told, sins similar to those described in these words will take place. We see evidence that Satan is first obtaining the control of human minds who have not the fear of God before them. Let all read and understand the prophecies of this book, that is the book of Daniel, for we are now entering upon the time of trouble spoken. So, whatever the power be, we are assured in Daniel 7:30 will be grieved and returned. We are in such a time, we see this history being repeated in combination with the revelation. We are told that the world is filled with storm and war and variance, yet under one head, the purple power, the people, yet under one head, the purple power, the people will unite to oppose God in the person of his witnesses. This union is cemented by the great apostate. While he seeks to unite his agents in warring against the truth, he will work to divide and scatter. It is Advocate 7182.2. And so we are saying that the things that happen in Daniel really will happen in the book of Revelation 13, Revelation 17, and Revelation 18, because we are told, study the book of Revelation in connection with the book of what? With the book of Daniel. So if Nebuchadnezzar, who is the king of Babylon, ordained an image to be worshipped, and it was really pointing to the God behind that image, what will the papacy do in the end in enacting Sunday sacredness as a day of worship? What will he be directing this worship to? Brothers and sisters, I want us to read a few quotes that relate to these end time issues. The papal power is the mystery of Babylon of Revelation 13, 17 and 18. What does Rome say that her central God is? What is this mystery that is central doctrine of the war? What was really Nebuchadnezzar doing in Daniel chapter 3? The mystery of the Trinity is the central doctrine of the Catholic faith. Upon it are based all other teachings of the church. So you name it, Sunday sacredness, immortality of the soul, purgatory, indulgence, confessions, and Eucharist. All these teachings are based on the mystery of the Trinitarian God. Every teaching. So when Sunday worship will be enacted, we saw that the image which was raised in Daniel chapter 3 is the same image which is raised in the book of Revelation chapter 13. So the very mystery behind the Sunday worshiping, all the doctrines of the purpose that will be enforced is the mystery of the Trinity. In the unity of that one only God of Babylonians, there were three persons. And to symbolize that doctrine of Trinity, they employed, as the discoveries of Layard prove, the equilateral triangle, just as it is well known the Romish church does at this day, the two Babylons by Alexander Hislop, chapter 2. And so, brothers and sisters, we are seeing that the raising of the image in Daniel chapter 3 was for the gods of Babylon. It symbolized, that image symbolized Trinity. Maybe this is something that we don't teach in our crusades or evangelistic campaigns, not crusades. Crusades are for Islams. In evangelistic campaigns, we do not teach Daniel chapter 3 as it should be taught. When Nebuchadnezzar was raising the image, Alexander Hislop in chapter 2 of 2 Babylon says the image was a symbol of the doctrine of Trinity. So if the Jewish boys could worship that image, they were not per se worshiping the image that actually Nebuchadnezzar had raised, but they were worshiping the Trinitarian God of Nimrod, Semiramis, and Tammuz. When the papacy, which is the spiritual Babylon, will raise the image of Sunday to be worshiped in Revelation 13, 17, and 18, it will be the spiritual Trinity, God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Spirit. And not only that, but going further backward to the worship of Nimrod, Semiramis, and the sun Tammuz. And so we are told, and I hope these things resonate with us. Now, this is the Catholic faith. We worship one God in the Trinity and the Trinity in unity, without either confusing the persons or dividing the substance. For the person of the Father is one, the Son is another, the Holy Spirit is another. But the Godhead of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit is one, their glory equal, their majesty co-eternal. Athanasian Creed, New Catechism, page 67 and 68. And we read again, the mystery of the Most Holy Trinity is the central mystery of Christian faith and life. It is the mystery of God in himself. It is the mystery of God in himself. It is therefore the source of all the other mysteries of faith, the light that enlightens them. It is the most fundamental and essential teaching in the hierarchy of the truths of faith. Because, and now see what Sunday sacredness is all about. This is Adventist Review and Sabbath Herald, April 4, 1854. It says, this day is Sunday, because it is a day dedicated by the apostles to the honor of the Most Holy Trinity. So Sunday sacredness is a day dedicated to the worship of Trinity. So we are not just speaking here about people worshiping on a day. There is nothing wrong on worshiping on Sunday, Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday, Friday, and Saturday. But when a command is issued that such and such a day is worshipped, we should go in the background and find more information why such an injunction is being given to the people. And we see the raising of the image in Daniel chapter 3 and the raising of the image in Revelation 13, 17, and 18. It is for the dedication of the Holy Trinity. Now, the Sabbath was given by the Lord to distinguish between the worship of the true God and the false God. If then we worship the wrong God, what only we receive is really the false glory. And this problem of worshiping the mysterious God is permeated in Christendom, that they do not know what they are doing actually. In Adventism, this is what we read, and it is a very sad thing to read of such a things happening among us, the people who should know these things better than other people. From Fernando, we read from Fernando L. Cannell, the Handbook of Seventh-day Adventist Theology, SDA Encyclopedia, it says that doctrine of the concept of the Trinity, namely the idea that three are one, is not explicitly but only assumed. While no single scriptural passage sets formally the doctrine of the Trinity, it is assumed as a fact by Bible writers and mentioned several times. Only by faith can we accept the essence of the Trinity. Again, we read, the role of the Trinity in a doctrine of God always raises questions. One reason is that the word itself does not appear in the Bible, nor is there any clear statement of the idea. But the Bible does set the stage for its formulation, and the concept represents a development of biblical claims and concepts. So even though the doctrine of the Trinity is not part of what the Bible itself says about God, it is part of what the church must say, safeguard the biblical view of God. So even amongst the people who understand the truth, we find this concept of God and worship being brought in the church of God. This is the very thing that actually the Greek party expressed, and they rejected worshiping this false God. And also, as a people, we should actually refuse to worship the this false God. God. As we close, I want us just to look at what actually we are taught. I just want us to look at what we are told by the prophet. This is what she says. Christ says that there will be those in the church who represent parables and suppositions when God has given grand, elevating, ennobling truths, which should ever be kept in the treasure house of the mind. When men pick up this theory and that theory, when they are curious to know something, it is not necessary for them to know God is not leading them. It is not his plan that his people shall present something which they have to suppose, which is not taught in the word of God. So you find Fernando and other Adventist
theologians saying that we suppose, this is a theory, this is a concept. The prophet is saying that we should not accept supposition, theories, and concepts, but what the Lord has said. So what is the type, antitype of what happened with Israel and with us who are just about to enter into heaven? As we come to a close, I want you to see what is being spoken in PP 689, paragraph 1. I want you to listen to this. I want you to read carefully. Satan was determined to keep his hold on the land of Canaan. And when it was made the habitation of the children of Israel, and the law of God was made the law of the land, he hated Israel with a cruel and malignant hatred and plotted their destruction. Through the agents of evil spirits and strange gods were introduced. And because of transgression, the chosen people were finally scattered from the land of promise. This history Satan is striving to repeat in our day. God is leading his people out of from the abominations of the world that they may keep his law. And because of this, the rage of the accused of brethren knows no bounds. The devil is come down unto you, having great wrath, because he knoweth that he hath but a short time. Revelation 12, 10 and 12. The antitypical land of promise is just before us. And Satan is determined to destroy the people of God and cut them off from their inheritance. The admonition, watch and pray lest you enter into temptation, was never more needed than now. The word of the Lord to ancient Israel is addressed also to his people in this age. Regard not them that have familiar spirit, neither seek after wizard to be defiled by them. For all that do these things are an abomination unto the Lord. And so the devil, in order to keep Canaan land, he introduced strange lands. In antitypical, for him to make us lose heaven, he introduces also strange gods. And the children of God has to really battle with this. In Malachi chapter 4, 6, we are told that God shall send Elijah. And the work of Elijah was to destroy the false gods of Baal at Mount Carmel. And so the children of God who shall be called as Elijahs, also they have to battle with this false god that shall be introduced among them and not regard this strange god. My admonition to us is that as a people of God, as the Elijah of the end time, we should restore the true worship of God. And as the three Hebrew worthies, when we are brought into a situation where we have to worship the false god, we should reject it. Why should we reject all these things? Because we are told that in Jeremiah chapter 2, verse 12, Jeremiah chapter 2, verses 11, we are told this as we close. This is what the Lord has told us. Jeremiah chapter 2, verses 11. Hath a nation changed their gods, which are yet no gods? But my people have changed their glory for that which does not profit. Idolatry is exchange of glory, which is character. Without the character of God, no one will see heaven. All who depart from God will surely perish. We are bound to show our abhorrence against all popish idol worship with all infidelity and religion. Those sinners, through their poor little multitude may be now above the sword of human justice, they will shortly find they are with the reach of God. Revelation 19, 20, and the beast was taken, and with him the false prophet that wrought miracles before him, which he deceived them, that he received the mark of the beast and them that worshipped his image. These both were cast alive into the lake of fire with brimstone. And so Daniel chapter 3 is an attack on the first table of the commandments. Revelation chapter 13 is an attack of the same. And all this, we have to understand the underhand dealings of the devil. Let us pray that the Lord will give us a spirit to withstand all these abominations that are happening in the world and in the churches. I hope the Lord will give you strength. I pray that the Lord will be with you. And more we shall continue studying and understanding what the will of God is. May the Lord bless us. Shall we close with a word of prayer? Shall we close with a word of prayer? Our Heavenly Father, we see what is happening in the world in the churches. We see what happened in Daniel chapter 3 is coming to be repeated in an acting of the Sunday Lord. We pray to make us a spirit that we'll be able to understand all these things. We praise your name because you have revealed these things to us beforehand. And so give us the strength to go through the crisis that is coming. This we ask in Jesus' name. Amen.